Oké. Welcome, everyone. Sorry to interrupt, but we're already live for the people watching. But I just wanted to ask everyone to start getting seated. Also, I'll get in the screen for a second so that people actually see me. For the people at home, I realize there's a little bit of a flickering in the screen. I'm trying to get that to go away. For everyone here on location, welcome. We're going to have a presentation in a few seconds. Feel free to already get seated. And yeah, we will start in a second. For now, I want to welcome you all. For the people that haven't been here before at the Innovation Café, we're a networking event, basically also showing what Eindhoven has to offer in the fields of tech and design. We're a weekly program. We're here every Thursday from at this time. So feel free to come again. We have a very interesting program. You could watch it on ehvinnovationcafe.org. Today we have a presentation by Frans van de Vossen, and he's going to talk a little bit about the artificial womb. So without further ado, I'd like to give the word to Frans. I don't know if everyone in the back there would like to take a seat before we start, so it's a little bit less messy. And there might be some people walking in during. Try to not take too much notice of it. And afterwards we can go into some questions if people have them. For the people at home, if you have questions, feel free to put them in the live chat as well so we can ask them to Frans afterwards. So Frans, please take it away.
Thank you very much, Margot. Also, thank you for inviting me and give me the opportunity to present something of the work we do on what we call the artificial womb. I will try to explain today, first of all, what we mean with the artificial womb, because you can think and come up with all kinds of ideas, and I hope that after this presentation, at least our idea about the artificial womb is clear. And what I also will do is I will try to visualize and to make clear how we try to come from an idea to develop such an artificial womb, and I will tell you why this is important, how we go from an idea to finally a final product that we hope to have also on the market so that it also can be used. So that's what we will do today. First of all, what is the problem we are looking at and the problem we are facing? That's the problem that the mortality and morbidity of preterm birth, and that is birth before 37 weeks of gestation, is worldwide quite high. So we have about 50 million preterm births worldwide a year, and about 10% of these births is earlier than 37 weeks. That sounds very high, but I will explain a little bit that for most of these, this is not really a problem, but for the extremely preterm children, this is a problem. And this is visualized in this picture I show here below. There we see, and maybe it's not always easy to see, that we have gestation age between 22 and 23 weeks, 24, 25, 26 to 31, and 32 to 36. That's a little bit how it is, so it's not linear. And there we can see that most of the preterm birth is 80% in this range of 32 to 36. And if you look at how these preterms will come to world, to the world, is that only a few of them, 2 to half to 2%, will have a disadvantage being that earlier. But if we go to even earlier weeks, then there is a problem, especially if you look at 22 to 23 weeks, and in the Netherlands, 23 weeks is a little bit the age which is concerned to be viable. Children from 24 to 25 weeks have actually a 50% survival rate, if we can mention it in this way, and that's not very much. And the other 50% come to world either healthy, but mostly also with either a mildly or even a severe handicap. So that's a real problem. So we focus actually on this group of preterms, so say between 23, 24 and 26, 27 weeks, that's about 7% of all the preterms. So, and in the Netherlands, this is about 800. I took the numbers of 2019. And they have a not very good prognosis, as you can see. So, and the reason for that is because to let these preterms survive, we have to treat them in an incubator. And what is done in an incubator is that these children, and here you see a picture how this looks like, they get respiratory support. So they get support for respiration and that's an air-based way. So they are given air as if they were mature, as if they were, say, 40 weeks. And the main problem there is that the lungs of these preterm babies are not ready to deal with that. So they cannot actually have this respiratory support. And we can see that in this image. Here you see images how the lungs develop. And so these are the lungs of preterms of 26 to 36 weeks. And they are far from fully mature, like the lungs of a 40 weeks old baby. And these lungs should actually be under in a liquid environment, like in the natural womb, and shouldn't be respirated by an incubator. So then the idea is the following, and that was inspired by the work done by Alan Flake. They managed to have a lamb, a preterm lamb, in a liquid environment. So you see the lamb moving and living in a liquid environment. And here you see the schematic scheme how this is done. So what there is done is this lamb is not respirated, so the oxygen is provided by a connection of the umbilical cord to an oxygenator. So what is done there is that the placenta of the mother is replaced by an oxygenator. What the placenta does is transfer oxygen from mother's blood to the baby's blood, and that is exactly what this oxygenator is also doing. So these lambs do not have to breathe. They get their oxygen through the umbilical cord, like in the natural womb. And in Philadelphia, they managed to let this lamb survive and even let it survive in such a way that it could walk around afterwards. So that's the idea, which would be nice, of course, if we could transfer that to humans. If we are able to do that in humans, then we could save all these young preterm babies between 24, 28 weeks. So what we need to do is we need to develop a perinatal life support. That's how we call this artificial womb. You can call it also a perinatal life support. Life support, perinatal, means in between prenatal and neonatal. You can do that, and that's of course a technical challenge, but also a challenge in all other kind of aspects. So what we aim to do is to develop, but also validate a perinatal life support system, using Flake's breakthrough technology shown in this sheep. So that means that we must enable supply of oxygen but also nutrients through the fetal umbilical cord and connected to what is called an artificial placenta. So what I will try to do today is give an idea how we go from this idea to something that in the end should work in a safe way, in an accepted way, and of course properly working. And actually what we need to do is go from more or less science, this is more science maybe than engineering, what can we do? And we have to go from science to engineering. And I would also like to take the opportunity today to give my ideas, or not only my ideas, what is the difference between science and engineering? I work at the School of Engineering, actually, and I explain my students that what we do is not always science. And that is also not important. What is science? Then you try to acquire knowledge based on what we call a scientific method. And that means that we observe and describe observations that we see, that we try to formulate a hypothesis to explain what we see. And think of Newton, seeing this apple falling down. That was science. Use this hypothesis to predict results of new observations. So if it's not an apple but something else falling down, will that be the same? And in the end, perform experiments different from the one you observe to verify this hypothesis. So that's typically science. And what is important in science is the first two things is to describe a phenomena, but also to formulate a hypothesis, to explain it. And actually what you do then is you create a predictive model. So you create a model of a phenomena that you observed during whatever kind of activities. So a predictive model is actually a conceptual representation of some phenomena. And I mention this model because it will come back later. This model is a key player in our work. So this model can be an experimental model, but can also be a mathematical model. The second law of Newton is a mathematical model. And it will mostly refer only to a part of the phenomena you observe. The model is always only a part of what you see, not the complete thing. So, that's what I always tell my students. We learn not from what the model predicts, but mostly from what the model does not predict. And that's why modeling is so important, because it tells you what you don't understand. Another thing that is important is a quote by Einstein, everything should be made as simple as possible, but not simpler. So these models should be as simple as possible, and not simpler means not too simple. I also work with designers more and more, and this is the Saint-Exupéry. You know him maybe from Le Petit Prince, but he was also a designer. And he had the following quote: a designer knows he has achieved perfection not when there's nothing left to add, but when there's nothing left to take away. And that's more or less even a better way of saying than Einstein did. So the models we will make should be such that they are as simple as possible, cannot take anything away, but not such that you add all kind of things that are not important. Okay, now engineering. What is engineering? And we call that the engineering method. So you have the scientific method, but also the engineering method. And there we look at research questions that originate from practical problems, not from what you are curious about, but a real practical problem. And that can be a problem from the clinic, but can also be a problem in whatever kind of area. But we will use the knowledge in science, mathematics, and experiments, but also the experience we have to find a solution to that problem. So engineering is more finding solutions. Not trying to understand something, no, find solutions. So we will use the scientific method and mathematical and experimental modeling. So here this model is again important. So modeling is important in science, but in the same way also in engineering. Last quote today from Karman: scientists study the world as it is, engineers create the world that has never been. And that's what we are doing if we create an artificial world. But we have to study the world as it is. So we have to study the real natural womb to be able to create one that solves our problems. So that's a little bit some words about how we work. So what we have learned from that is that these predictive models, they are key ingredient of what we do. So if we go indeed from an idea to a product, we need models to be able to do that. I will talk also a little bit about modeling. And I always like to use the following example. So if we buy a car nowadays, this is an old car. But if you buy a car now, then you buy also the computer. So in the car, you will find, you will find a computer. And if something is wrong with the car, mostly something is wrong with the computer. And of course, you have an engine in the car. And what does this computer do? It does the following. It knows exactly what you want to do with the car, and it has to tell the motor how to do that. So it has to change all kinds of parameters, all kinds of things to make this motor exactly do what you want. To be able to do that, it needs to know what is the state of the motor. Is it warm? Is it cold? Is it whatever? So it does all kinds of measurements that is interpreted in some way, feedback to this model, this computer, and that will be used to make the proper way of running this motor, and that gives the output. And we all know this software is in all cars and can also be misused, like we learned recent years, that you know exactly that the motor is on the roller band, so you make sure that the production of CO2 is low enough. That's this kind of software. Okay, we call this model predictive control. And so you use a model that can predict what the motor will do to control what it does. That's what we try to do. And we can translate this also to the clinic. So we can also look at an incubator, for instance. For this case, I took the incubator. And we have to control what is going on, temperature, whatever kind of oxygen. We have to control that. How do we do that? By measuring everything that's going on, use this measurement, and then use a model again that can predict if I change something, what the output will be. So that's important, that the model decides how the system must be altered, as it knows the state of the system, but it also can predict its behavior. And that's important. If you don't can are not able to predict the behavior, you don't know what to do. Okay. So that's model predictive control. You can use that also, of course, in the hospital. And then this system I was talking about, it was first, there was a car, then it was an incubator, but could be also a patient. If you can model a patient, so if you can predict what happens with a patient if you do something, you can predict its future, then you can make the same loop. And then we call it model predictive decision support. So you know the state of the patient because you measure blood pressure, you measure temperature, you measure whatever you want, all kind of blood values, or make some images with MRI. So you have all the information and you have a model that can predict what happens if you do some intervention. And that intervention can be give a drug, or that intervention can be perform an operation, make a bypass. And this model can predict what happens if you make a bypass. And if you know what happens, you can also decide, okay, maybe it's a good idea to do that, or maybe it's not a good idea. And that's something that is very slowly becoming more and more important in the hospitals. If you think about a doctor, normally he decides to do with the patient based on what he knows from all the other patients. That is how a doctor normally works. An engineer works in another way. If an engineer wants to predict, wants to change something, make a bridge, then it will compute if the bridge is good enough and not start make the same bridge as last time because it's a new situation. So that's what we want to achieve. And this patient could, of course, also be our perinate. And so what we will do in our work is make sure that we make models that can predict how these perinates will develop if we intervene, if we do something, or if we do nothing. It's also something. So that's what this decision support system, and we'll talk about the decision support later on, actually does. Okay. So let's go back to the simple car, because I will explain you a new hype. It's called a digital twin. And in presentations like this, it's always difficult to talk about a digital twin because everybody thinks on this perinate. But a digital twin is a virtual representation of a real physical dynamic system. So actually, this computer in our car with the model is a digital twin of the real car. And that is called digital twin. And we call this digital twin technology. So to use what you know about a dynamic system, about a car, to let it work optimally. Or to design it in a better way. So in car industry, but also in the airplane industry, or in all kind of industry, digital twins of the real thing are used to optimize design. And that, of course, we will use also in our digital, in our for our perinatal life support system. And the nice thing is we can also make digital twins of persons. I can make a digital twin of myself. So that means a computer program that can predict what happens with me if you do something. So if I take some pills, get healthy, this program should be able to predict what happens with me, if that is a good idea or not. Or if I go and do sporting, this computer program should predict if this sporting is good for me or not. So then we have also a computer program, but that predicts what happens with the person. So that's your digital twin of a person. So it's not always a system that you like a car or an incubator, but also you can have a digital twin of a person. And this is nowadays used in healthcare more and more. Think about a model we have of the heart that can predict what happens if I make a bypass. Suppose I have a problem with my coronary arteries. The doctor sees, okay, maybe I should treat this guy or maybe not. I don't know, is it severe or not. Then this model can tell the doctor, if you do this, that will happen. So then the doctor will use the digital twin of me. Of course, it needs all kind of information. Who am I? How big I am? What's my blood pressure? So you need also data. So you have a mechanistic model of the heart and the coronary arteries. You have a lot of data, and together you can predict what happens with a certain person, and then you can use that to tell that person to do something, to go and do sports or to take medicine or whatever. A new thing is now, and that's big data, that we not only use the digital twin of me, but also the digital twins of the whole population. If I have the digital twins of all of you, I can also use that information to make a better decision about me, because some of you looks like me, and they learned how this behaves. So that's the digital twin of a population, and this can be used together to make healthcare a little bit different from now. Okay, yeah. Let's go on, because another thing you can do is use a digital twin. Here we have the digital twin again, to control a setup. So this is I took this example, so this is a model, an experimental model of the left ventricle, these two valves, and we use that to study the flow in the left ventricle. But I want this pump to behave like my heart. So it should do what my heart does if I, for instance, close this aorta. So there also I have a computer program. Now I have a device, and I use the digital, and this computer program knows exactly how this device works. So it's a digital twin of the device. Use all information to control the device. So that's also in our perinatal life support system. We would be happy to have a computer program that can tell our system what to do, because it knows what the effect will be. So it becomes complicated now. We have a digital twin of the perinate. We have a digital twin of the perinatal life support system. And maybe also a digital twin of the people that work with it. You can make that as complex as possible. But it's always the same structure. Here we see an experiment, actually. So it's not a digital twin, and it's work done by Juliette. She's here. She can show you later maybe also this mannequin. And you see, if you look very careful, that's made such that it can breathe. At least it looks like breathing. But that is because it is controlled by a computer program, again, that tells how this mannequin, how this chest must move to simulate breathing. And that means that you can test sensors if they work very well. So you make also a physical twin, and use then a digital twin to control the physical twin and to simulate reality. And that's what we also try to do in our development of the perinatal life support system. Here you see how a mannequin could look like if you plug in all kind of functionality. It will be difficult to put everything in one mannequin, but few of these functionalities can be put into the mannequins. And these mannequins then can be used, first of all, to learn how things are in real world, because you cannot make it if you don't know how it is in real world. But secondly, also to test our devices. And thirdly, to train the people that needs to work with it later on. So that's three important functions. Okay, let me see. So let's see if we can go towards this solution. What we need, if we aim to develop and validate a perinatal life support system, then first of all, we need this liquid-filled environment. So this biobag or this sac in which this perinate will live for a while. And hopefully we will be able to make it different from that sac on the table, like you saw in the experiment. We will make sure that we make an environment that is not only good for the perinate, but also for the parents and for the doctors and whatever. That's quite a job. And we have to make this artificial placenta. So that's the part that is connected to the umbilical cord to make sure that the blood of the perinate gets oxygen, because the lungs are kept not functioning. That's one thing. Then, of course, we have to make this decision support system I was talking about. So we want to have this digital twin, not only of the liquid-filled environment, but also of the perinate. So computer programs that can tell us exactly how to operate the perinatal life support system, but also that can learn us how things work. Because to develop these programs, you have to know how it works. So it forces us to study how things are going on. We have to develop a monitoring system. We have to measure all kind of things. I showed you this loop. You know the we need measurements to do that. So the monitoring system is also important. Finally, we have to develop these mannequins, like I showed you, these physiological fetal mannequins. And we have, in some way, to make sure that we can validate everything we do. And of course, you can validate that in the hospital, but we need to validate that far before that. We want to make a first-time right product. You cannot make a product that is half functioning and do some tests and then go back, and that's not the way we want to work. Okay, so where we found a nice group of people doing this. And that's our European project. We got some money to do that. People from Milan, people from Aachen, a group here, LifeTech Group, Eindhoven, and also Nemo, a company. So that's a good start to do all these things I mentioned earlier. And each of them work on several parts. We have the group in Aachen working on this oxygenator. We have the group at Eindhoven working on these mannequins. We have another group in Eindhoven working on the decision support system and the modeling, the digital twin. We have a group in Milan working together with a company working on the monitoring system. So we have all people that are at least working on this technical development. Here you see, and I will go fast because I think also that we need to hurry a little bit. This is the prototype of the oxygenator. So that's the part that is connected to the umbilical cord to make sure that there's oxygen in the blood that is circulating. And it's a difficult thing to do because you only have a very small amount of blood and the heart of the perinate must be able to pump it. So there must be not a big resistance in this, otherwise the baby cannot pump the blood through it. Here you see, I just took an example of these mathematical models that we develop to indeed be able to compute how things work. Then we have people work on, Milan people working on sensors that can be put on the skull of the baby to measure blood perfusion in the brain, because the brain is the important thing we have to keep in a good condition. And we have the people that work on the whole system. This is the system how it looks like now in Aachen. And that's really a prototype. That's not the one we want to have in the hospital. Maybe it could look like this later on. So we have to work on this to make from this prototype that maybe could work. That we could maybe do some experiments in that. But that's not the final product. So we also have to think about how can we bring this to the market. And we decided to do that in an early stage. And today or soon, there will be a company called Juno that you can find here, the website that is mainly run by Jasmijn and Laila Kok, that will start a company. And that company will make sure that the knowledge that is everywhere in the world is brought together. So it will tell other people also, make a company so we can buy your product. So you cannot take everything to yourself, that will not work, but it will encourage other people to make parts of our whole system in such a way that we can build it and use it in a proper way. So, to conclude, we have these activities done. What I try to tell you is that we really must have a first-time wide product. So we want to develop something that is ready to use immediately without all kinds of tests to be done before. Of course, you have to do some tests, but as little as possible. We need also to have specialized knowledge. not only to build the system, but also to use the system. So we are now making a big consortium of all the medical centers in the Netherlands, and they all agree to work on this, that's very nice, to make a consortium of people that have the knowledge to use this system in a proper way. Because you can make a perfect system, but if it is not used in a proper way, then it will not be very good. So that's also what we work on. We work on this digital twin technology, and I hope I showed you a little bit what we mean with this. We work on the monitoring system, decision support system, and what is important to do this validation. And we do that step by step using mannequins, and later maybe other clinical studies. Of course, laughing, that is also important, and that's maybe also why we are here, is we need, of course, a broad support of users. And that can be the parents of the children, that can be the doctors, but that can also be the community itself. So that's what we are working on, and hopefully that will bring us to a situation that we really can help these young babies in such a way that they survive in a much better way than now. So that was my presentation.
Can anyone hear? Everyone hear me? Are there any questions from the audience? Yes. Frans, can you please repeat the question after it's? I can give you the mic.
Okay.
Yeah. Just as an engineer, I'm technically interested how the transition goes from the birth, so to speak, to connecting the navel string to the machine.
Yeah.
So also, how fast should that be done, and how is that foreseen?
Yeah, so the question is, how do we get this perinate in the biobag, actually, without exposing it to air? That's also important. And therefore, there is has been developed already, and also patented, a device that uses the natural vaginal birth channel, in which the perinate is actually captured in the sac, without any contact with the environment. And that's also important because it must be sterile, and there must be no breeze reflection. But that's already, we are looking at that. So also this kind of small products. Yeah, so in the sac where you capture the baby, there will be, of course, an opening left for the umbilical cord. Once you pull it out, you can just take it and then connect it to the oxygenator. Not too long, yeah. So also there, we are thinking about developing a device that can do this cutting immediately, also make the connection, and also measure kind of like pH and things like that. So we have all kind of things in mind already to work on. Because it's not only the perinatal life support system itself, but all the things around, and also the people around, that should be take care of.
Any other questions?
There's always two answers to this. First of all, they come with the problem, and those are always enthusiastic. Otherwise, they wouldn't come up with the problem. What I see in building this consortium, this Dutch consortium of all the hospitals, they are all enthusiastic, and they all want to work together, and all are, I guess, convinced that if maybe not we will develop that system, others will do, and they will have to work with that. So I don't see any people there that don't like the idea. But of course, they see all kind of complications, and that's good. That's what we need to develop a good product.
We have time for one more short question, if there is one. Yes, over there.
That's always the question. What we plan to do in this European project, and that was a project of 4 years, to come up with a prototype, and that means that is a system that in practice could work, but it's not safe yet, it's not so we cannot use it. But to have a prototype that has all technological aspects included. And that will be in from now in 2.5 years. So that's the first prototype. We are quite on track with that. I'm happy to see that that goes well. Then there comes the very difficult phase from this prototype to a product that can be used. So therefore we have to follow all the regulatory things, and but we will also encourage all kind of new problems, of course, and that can take another 4 years or maybe more, but let's say 6 years from now we should be close.
Great. Then we're going to round up. So Frans, thank you so much. I'm just going to stand here so that when people at home aren't just listening to like a voice in the room. Thank you for your presentation and answering the questions. Also for everyone coming. I know a lot of you are going to stay for dinner, right? Like I see some heads nodding. For those people, there's already a table ready for you guys if you want to head out there straight away, but you're also welcome to have a drink, but it needs to be in here in this space. I will also ask a colleague to come by and ask if someone else wants to drink something, if you want to catch up with other people here in this space. So feel free to do that, and otherwise when you guys are ready you can head to the bar head to the service team to ask that you want to join for the dinner. For the other people, there is a possibility also to have a meal afterwards. There's an Innovation Cafe special, a nice pasta dish. If you want to join us, you can also let us know at the bar. And that was it for the people at home. Everyone watching us online, thank you for watching. I hope to see everyone again next week. So thanks.